गुड मॉर्निंग माय स्टूडेंट्स, ऑलरेडी वी हैव स्टार्टेड डिस्कसिंग केमिस्ट्री ऑफ एडवांस्ड मटेरियल्स एंड इन द लास्ट फ्यू क्लासेस वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द नैनो मटेरियल्स, नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द चैप्टर कॉल्ड पॉलीमर्स। सो दीज आर द रेफरेंस बुक्स हियर एंड आई वुड रिकमेंड दैट अपार्ट फ्रॉम द स्लाइड्स यू शुड गो थ्रू दीज बुक्स, particularly the polymer chapter. So you know different kinds of polymeric materials we use in our daily life. So here you can see different kind of polymeric materials which you can generally find in the for our daily applications, like polyethylene polystyrene, polyethylene HDPE means high density polyethylene, or it may be LDPE, low density polyethylene. You also know the plastic bottles which are often made up of polyethylene tetraethylate. The other polymers like polyester, nylon, these are also common to most of you. Now we will learn what is polymer. So the term polymer, you are all aware about the term polymer from your either 10th or 10th plus 2 classes. So now to recall the thing again, so polymers, we can say these are the macromolecules which are built up by the linking together of a large number of small molecules, and these small molecules are called monomers. So polymers are basically composed of monomers. So large molecules are built up by the repetition of simple chemical unit, and the repeat units are linear or branched. Now another term which is very important to understand the polymer, it is the degree of polymerization. So the degree of polymerization is the number of repeating units which is present in that polymers. So we can say the number of repeating units that is present in the polymer, and the total molecular weight of the polymer is the product of molecular weight of the repeating unit and the degree of polymerization. So here you can see some of the examples of the polymer that are composed of certain monomers. The first example is the polyethylene, and here polyethylene is composed of repeating units of ethylene. Another example is that polystyrene, and the monomer is that styrene. Third example is the polypropylene, which is composed of propylene units. So I would like to recommend this, you please draw these structures in the your notebook along with the monomer units, monomer as well as the polymer. So these are the examples and you practice it, okay? Now, you know the building blocks of polymers are called monomers. So when the polymeric materials composed of same repeating unit, it is called homopolymer. So here you can see homopolymer, it is composed of the same repeating unit MMMM. But when in the polymeric chain there are more than one monomer, it is called copolymer. Here in the example you can see that M1, M2, then M1, M2 again. So the repetition of M1, M2, M1, M2. So this is a copolymer. It is composed of two different monomers, that is M1 as well as M2. So depending on the arrangement of these monomeric units into the polymers can be classified at random alternating block and graft. So what I said, if you have more than one monomeric unit, these are called copolymers. So We can classify the copolymers as random, alternating, block and trap. So suppose you have two monomers, monomer A and monomer B. In the slide you can see when the A and B are randomly in the chain, it is called the random polymer. In the second figure you can see that A and B are alternate in polymer chain, and you can say it alternating polymer chain. Now in the block copolymer, you will find a small block of A and then small block of B, then again small block of A, then small block of B. So this is called the block copolymer. So here the blocks of A monomers and the blocks of B monomer are arranged. Then graft copolymer means one monomer is grafted over the other. So here you can see the repeating unit means A is grafted. So B is grafted over A in the figure 4. So in this slide basically we have learned that we can classify the polymer depending on the type of monomer arrangement. So if we have this same monomer, we can call it homopolymer. If we have that more than one monomer in the polymeric chain, we can call it is copolymer. So and the classification of copolymer in random, alternating, block and graft. Another important classification of polymers is in terms of the tacticity. The tacticity is the orientation, better I should say configuration. So the tacticity is the orientation or configuration of monomeric units in a polymeric chain. So when the configuration of the functional groups are all this in the same side of the chain, it is called the isotactic polymer. So the example of isotactic polymer is that polypropylene made by Ziegler-Natta catalyst, and here you can see the R, it is highlighted in red color. So you can see the R, these are in the same side of the chain. So when the configuration of the functional groups are random, it is called the atactic polymer. So the example is the polyvinyl chloride, and as you can see the position of R is random. So few are one side of the chain and few are at the opposite side of the chain. So this is called the atactic polymer. So when the arrangements or configuration of the functional groups are in alternating fashion, it is called the syndiotactic polymer. So here you can see the R is in on the alternating fashion. So it is the syndiotactic polymer. So if you summarize, so in accordance to the tacticity, we can classify the polymers in three different polymer, like these are isotactic, atactic and then syndiotactic polymer. So now in the exam, if you get the question, write short note on the classification of polymers in terms of tacticity. So you'll have to define the tacticity and then you'll have to classify that, and you'll have to give the example of that thing along with the diagram. Okay. So the functionality of monomer, now we will start the functionality of monomer. So the number of bonding sites present in a monomer is called or is referred as functionality of that monomer. So suppose if you have that monomer methanol CH3OH, here this OH is only one functional group which can participate for the preparation of polymer. So we can say that methanol, ethanol or aniline, here we have only one functional group. So these are called monofunctional monomers. Now we have bifunctional monomers like ethinyl, CCl2, double bond CCl2. In these monomers we have two binding sites which can act as a binding site to the preparation of polymers. Like multifunctional monomers SiOH whole 4, here you have four or three depending what you want. So you have more than one functional groups here, so it is called the multifunctional monomer. Now you see the importance of functionality. So now bifunctional monomer alone can form linear homopolymer. So if you have that bifunctional monomer, try to imagine a bifunctional monomer means ethylene. So you can form a linear homopolymer out of the ethylene. So if you have the trifunctional polymer, you can yield branched or cross-linked polymer. So try to imagine this. If you have trifunctional polymer, you can yield branched or cross-linked polymer. Now if you have a mixture of bifunctional and trifunctional monomers, that can produce branched or cross-linked polymer. And mixture of two bifunctional monomers yield branched or cross polymers. So this is all about this functionality of monomers. Now we'll discuss different kind of polymerization reactions. Depending on the type of polymerization reaction, we can classify the formation of polymers mainly in three types: addition polymerization, condensation polymerization, and copolymerization. So addition, it is often called the chain polymerization. It is a reaction that yield a product which is exact multiple of the original monomeric molecules. Chain growth polymers are prepared by chain reactions. Monomers are added to the growing end of the polymer chain, and the conversion of the vinyl chloride to polyvinyl chloride is an example. So if you see the example, vinyl chloride here, it's a monomer, and out of this monomer we are preparing a polymer, the polyvinyl chloride. Okay, so this is one by one addition reaction. You take one monomer of vinyl chloride, then you add another vinyl chloride into it, and then again you repeat the same thing. You are continuously growing the chain of monomer, and from that you are getting this polymer. So this is the type of polymerization, and it is called the addition or chain polymerization. So you are building the chain by adding the monomers. Addition polymerization reaction is initiated by application of heat, light, pressure or a catalyst for breaking down the double covalent bonds of monomer. So we will discuss it a little later. Okay, so mechanism of addition polymerization. Mainly for that addition polymerization, this reaction occurs in three steps. One is the initiation, then chain propagation, and then chain termination. So for the preparation of this addition polymerization, we should have one initiating agent. Often these peroxides are used as an initiating agent for the preparation of addition polymerization. So like here you can see peroxide in the first step, that is in initiation process, first peroxide, which is basically an initiator, it will form the radical dot, you can see. So radical plus CH2 double bond CHG, so this is a monomer, it will form another radical, so CH dot G. Now CH dot G, again it will react with the CH2 double bond CHG, okay, so it will form the again another dot, so then again another addition of this CH2 double bond CHG. So means here the polymerization is growing by adding one by one monomer unit. Ultimately the chain will terminate when two such radicals will add together and it will form a polymer. So basically the addition polymerization, it goes through the initiation, propagation and termination reaction. So initiation step, you will have to show that one initiator is being used and that initiator is used to prepare one radical, then one radical again it reacts with another molecule of monomer, then it slowly it is growing the polymeric chain, and then ultimately two radicals join and it will form the main polymer, which is your your target, and it is the chain termination step. Now we are going to discuss about the condensation polymerization. So all of you are aware about the condensation reaction. So condensation means two molecules will react and then a small molecule will liberate out of it. So maybe that is H2O, that may be HCl. So like if you take the example of amide linkage, so if you have that acid, carboxylic acid plus amine, as you can see here, when this carboxylic acid and amine, it goes through the reaction condensation, and here you can see the condensation of water. Likewise for the formation of ester linkage, like acid plus alcohol, so here you can see the carboxylic acid and then alcohol, RO, R double dust OH. So the formation of ester, RCOOR dot and then H2. So these are the typical example of condensation reaction. Left panel shows the amide linkage and the right side shows that ester linkage. In both the cases, you are getting water as a condensation product. Now, this is the typical condensation reaction. Likewise, if you have a diamine and then adipoyl chloride, it will, by the condensation reaction, it will form the nylon 6,6 polymer. So this is an example of condensation polymer, nylon 6,6, and it is very important for the exam. So nylon 6,6 for the preparation of, I will discuss it little later about the formation of the nylon 6,6, since it is very important and it has a huge commercial impact. So now for the time being, you should remember that the example of condensation polymer is the nylon 6,6, and it is produced by the condensation reaction of diamine and adipoyl chloride. Okay. So here you have some examples of condensation reactions as well. So you go through it. In the first example, it is diol plus diacid, and in the second, this is diamine plus diacid. So basically, these are the example of
condensation, de-extension, condensation, polymerization.
So now, in the exam you may get the question, the difference between the addition and condensation polymer. So now you know the what is addition and what is the condensation polymerization. Addition polymerization means you are growing the chain step, but here in condensation polymers you have two molecular spaces present, and from that you are getting the polymer by condensation of water or small molecules. So addition polymerization only growth reacts, if you go through this comparison, addition polymerization only growth reaction adds repeating units one at a time to the chain, and for condensation polymerization any two molecular species present can react. So number of units increases steadily throughout the reaction for the addition polymerization, and then condensation polymers monomers disappears early in the reaction. For addition polymerization, longer reaction times have a little effect on molecular weight but gives higher yields. For condensation polymerization, to obtain high molecular weight, longer reaction time is essential. Now the copolymerization. So I have already defined you the copolymers. Copolymerization means you should have different monomers. Okay. So copolymerization is the joint polymerization of two or more monomer species. High molecular weight compounds obtained by the copolymerization are called copolymers. Several copolymers are commercially important, like sarin foot wrap is made from vinyl chloride and vinylidene chloride. Automobile tires are made from 1,3-butadiene and styrene. So you see here you will not find the condensation reaction. Yeah, the monomers are two different monomers, but this will not go through the condensation reaction. Okay. So here is the some examples of the copolymerization. So if we summarize the reactions for the preparation of polymers, so basically we can classify the reactions in three main reactions, like addition reactions, number one, two is the condensation reaction, and three is the copolymerization reaction. So you just go through it and you will have to remember the things for the exam. Again, another classification of polymers, that is basically the depending on the source of polymers. So where from we are getting these polymers? So sometimes these polymers are available in the nature, and sometimes we have to synthesize the polymers in the laboratory for different applications. Okay. So when we get the polymers from the nature, it is called the natural polymers. So natural polymers, here you can see the natural rubber. It's an example of natural polymer. The basic building block of this natural polymer is the isoprene unit. Very important. Isoprene unit, you just draw in your notebook. And from this isoprene monomer, you also draw the structure of natural rubber. Okay. So this is one example of natural polymer. Then synthetic polymer. So when you are preparing some polymers in the laboratory to achieve our desired properties, it is called the synthetic polymers. So mostly all the polymers like polyethylene, polypropylene, polystyrene, polyvinylidene, vinyl chloride, nylon, bakelite, these are all synthetic polymers.
We have another type of polymer depending on the source that you can call this semi-synthetic polymer. Semi-synthetic polymers. So as the name suggests, this is natural polymer, but if you add some chemicals into it in the laboratory, and if you make it a laboratory on the to achieve the desired properties. So the modification of natural polymer using some synthetic procedure, it is called the semi-synthetic polymer. So the when this you are halogenating or hydrohalogenating the natural rubber or cellulose, it is called the semi-synthetic polymers. See, now we have another classification of polymers. So we are going through the lot of classification of polymers, and it may confuse you. Okay, so after completion of these slides, I'll summarize the things. So what we have discussed. So now classification on the basis of structure. So linear polymers, as you can see, it can be linear, it can be branched. Okay, so linear polymers means in which monomeric units are joined in the form of long straight chains. So it is linear. For example, high density polyethylene, nylons, polyesters. So these will create a long chain, a linear chain. When it is linear chain, it is having the high density. But when it has some branch structure, like in the low density polyethylene, the density is lower due to poor packing of polymer chains in presence of branches. So the linear polymers will give you the high density polyethylene, and then branched chain will give you the low density polyethylene. So again, another thing is that three-dimensional network polymers or cross-link polymers. So you have linear, you have branch, now you have this cross-link polymers. As you can see here in the diagram, it contains monomers, molecules connected to each other by only covalent bonds. They are giant molecules in which movement of individual monomeric units is prevented by cross-linking. Due to presence of cross-links, they are hard, rigid, brittle, and do not melt but burn on strong heating. So bakelite, urea, formaldehyde, these are the examples. So we have again discussion on that some important polymers, and that time we will also discuss about this linear, branched, and then cross-linked polymers. Classification on the basis of growth polymer chain. So sometimes this has partly been discussed in our early slides. So chain growth polymers and step growth polymers. Chain growth polymers, you can say, which is the addition polymers, and the step growth polymers, you can say, first is the condensation, dimer formation, and again the addition of this another block. So the chain growth polymers are formed by the successive addition of monomer unit to the growing chain carrying a reactive intermediate. So this is basically the addition polymers. Step growth, a series of independent reactions involve bond formation, that is the condensation reaction, between two different monomers with loss of small molecules like H2, HCl, ammonia. So this has already been discussed while discussing this addition and then condensation. So now very important classification of polymers, and it is basically on the thermal response. It has huge impact on the commercial market, and depending on the thermal response of materials, polymeric materials, we can classify the polymers in two types. One is the thermoplastic and another is the thermosetting polymers. It is very, very important for the exam. It is very important to for getting the knowledge about the commercial polymers. Sometimes these are called the thermoset and sometimes and then thermoplast. So very important two polymers, thermoplast and the thermosetting. So now we learn what is the thermoplastic or thermoplast, and then what is thermosetting polymers or thermoset. So thermoplastic polymers are linear long chain polymers which can be softened on heating and hardened on cooling reversibly. So try to understand the things. Thermoplastic polymers, in which it can be softened when heated and it can be hardened and cooled. So this is process is the reversible process. So there are polymers which are linear long chain polymers, and if you heat it, it will be softened, and if you cool it, it will be hardened, and the process is reversible, and these polymers are called thermoplastic polymers. Their hardness is temporary property subject to the change of with the rise and fall of temperature. Examples: polyethylene, polypropylene, polystyrene. There are again some polymers where this transformation means from the transform to the soften to harden by the application of heat, it is not feasible. So the thermosetting polymers or the thermosets are those polymers which during molding get hardened, and once they have solidified, they cannot be softened. Even if you heat it, you cannot make it soften. So they are the permanent setting polymers, as the name suggests, thermoset. So they are permanent setting polymers. Such polymers during heating acquire three-dimensional cross-linked structure which predominantly strong covalent bonds. So the examples are polyester, bakelite, epoxy resin. So now, differences between the thermoplastic and thermosetting polymers. So thermoplastic polymers, they soften on heating readily, but thermosetting, they do not soften or on heating, on prolonged heating, however they burn. So this process is from soften to harden is not reversible for that thermosetting polymers. Number two, they consist of long chain linear molecules, means the thermoplastic and the thermosets, they are set molecules have three dimensional network structure joined by strong covalent bonds. Number three, they are mostly formed by addition polymerization process, these thermoplastics, and the thermosets are formed by the condensation polymerization process mostly. So for the thermoplastic, by reheating to a suitable temperature, they can be softened, reset and thus reused. But the thermosetting polymers, they retain their shape and structure even on heating. Hence, they cannot be reshaped and reused. So the thermoplastic materials, they are usually soft, weak. Thermosetting polymers, they are usually hard and they are strong. Thermoplastic, they can be reclaimed from wastes. Thermosetting, they cannot be reclaimed from wastes. Thermoplastics, they are usually soluble in some organic solvent. Thermosets, due to strong bond and cross-linking, they are insoluble in almost all organic solvents. So now these slides is very important, and you should know the difference and the definition of the thermoplastic and the thermosetting polymers. now, from the beginning, we learned about the polymers. We introduced the polymers and we have learned what is the definition of polymer. And then we learned what is homopolymer, what is copolymer. We have learned what is the functionality of monomer and classification in accordance to plasticity. Now I will show you the different classification of polymers. Since already we have discussed many classification of polymers, and now it's the time to summarize this. So here you can see there are classification, mainly five types of classification. First is the source. According to the source, you can classify the polymers as natural, synthetic and semi-synthetic. Okay. Structure. Structure wise, we can say this is linear, branched, three-dimensional. Method of synthesis, we can say addition, condensation and copolymerization. Growth of chain polymerize, growth of polymer chain, that is again chain growth and step growth. Molecular force, this is thermoplastic and thermoset. And then you will have to give the examples of all these polymers. So this is the first part of that polymer.
So now it is the time to do some of the numericals on the estimation of degree of polymerization. So already I mentioned what is degree of polymerization. Degree of polymerization means the number of repeating unit present in a polymer. So basically the molecular weight of the polymer is equal to the degree of polymerization into the molecular weight of the monomer. So the multiplication of the degree of polymerization and the molecular weight of the monomer will give you the molecular weight of the polymer. So based on this, we will now do some numericals, and that will clarify your thought. Okay, so I am now going to do some numericals. So you see the first numerical: determine the mole fraction of vinyl chloride and vinyl acetate in a copolymer having a molecular weight of 10,520 gram per mole and a degree of polymerization of 160. So see, here the vinyl chloride and the vinyl acetate, the chemical formula are given. So this vinyl chloride and vinyl acetate, since the chemical formula is given, so you will be knowing that molecular weight of that copolymer. So the total molecular weight is given and degree of polymerization is also given. So the mole fraction you'll have to estimate. Okay. So again I am telling, molecular weight of the polymer is equal to the degree of polymerization and the molecular weight of the repeating unit. So the second question is, if a vinyl chloride vinyl acetate copolymers has a ratio of 10:1 vinyl chloride to vinyl acetate and a molecular weight of 16,000 gram per mole, what is the degree of polymerization? So simply you do these two numericals I think you will be able to do this numerical. If you find any problem in estimating these results, let me know. But before that, we'll try to perform. Okay. Good. So now we will discuss the number average molecular weight and weight average molecular weight of a polymer. So these are very important to know, the number average molecular weight and the weight average molecular weight of the polymer. The number average molecular weight is the total weight of the sample divided by the number of molecules in the sample. So again, you just see the equation, number average molecular weight MN is equal to summation of the it's the total weight of the sample, that is the summation of Ni Mi divided by summation of Ni. Okay, N is the number of mole, M is the molecular weight. Okay, so this is the number average molecular weight. Weight average molecular weight is given by this equation. Mw is equal to summation of Wi Mi divided by summation of Wi. Wi is the weight fraction and Mi is the molecular weight. Okay, so the Wi again you can express is Ni Mi. So you can write that Mw is equal to Ni Mi square divided by summation of Ni Mi. Okay, so here you can see generally for the synthetic polymers Mw is always greater than that of Mn. Okay, if you find this Mn and Mw is equal, then this polymer is perfectly homogeneous. It means each molecule has same molecular weight. Now when this Mw and Mn is not the same, then that is a heterogeneous polymer, and the heterogeneity is expressed by the term disparity index. So the disparity index, or it is formally told poly dispersity index PDI or heterogeneity index, or simply disparity, is a measure of the distribution of molecular mass in a given polymer sample. The disparity index PDI is equal to Mw divided by Mn. So now as described in the last slide, all of you are now aware about the number average molecular weight and the weight average molecular weight of the polymer. So now to do these two numericals. So in the first numerical, in a polymer given that M1, N1, M2, N2, M3, N3, these are all given. So you calculate the number average and weight average molecular weight. So simply you put that equation that is given in the last slide, and you will be able to estimate that Mn and Mw values. In the second numerical, if you find this from the given polymer data, calculate the following number average molecular weight and weight average molecular weight. Here you can see the molecular weight range that is given 8000 to 12000, 12000 to 16000, 16000 to 20000, and 20000 to
24,000.
So you take the average, okay? So 8,000 and 12,000, so you take the 10,000 average molecular weight. Now you see the number fraction is 0.10, 0.30, 0.40, 0.20. And the summation of here, it is 1. Okay. So from this, you can easily calculate this number average and molecular weight. Number average molecular weight and the weight average molecular weight. So you please do it and let me know if you face any problem. I think it is easy and you will be able to do that. Okay, so mechanism of addition polymerization. Mainly for that addition polymerization, this reaction occurs in three steps. One is the initiation, then chain propagation, and then chain termination. So for the preparation of this addition polymerization, we should have one initiating agent. And often these peroxides are used as an initiating agent for the preparation of addition polymerization. So like here you can see the peroxide in the first step, that is in initiation process. First peroxide, which is basically an initiator, it will form the radical dot, you can see. So radical plus CH2 double bond CHG, so this is a monomer, it will form another radical, so CH dot G. Now CH dot G, again it will react with the CH2 double bond CHG, okay, so it will form the again another dot, so then again another addition of this CH2 double bond CHG. So means here, so the strongest among the three types of polymers is the fiber, whose chain are held strongly by intermolecular forces like hydrogen bonding. They are crystalline in nature and of high tensile strength due to strong intermolecular forces. The nylon, polyester, these are the some example of the fibers. So in the coming few slides, we are going to discuss little detail about this rubber, plastic, and then fiber. Okay. So as I told you, now we will learn little detail about the rubbers. So rubbers are called the elastomers. So since rubber is a polymer, we need to know what is the building block or what is the monomer of that rubber. And you know the monomer of the rubber is the isoprenamide, and here this figure has been drawn. So you just draw this figure of this isoprenamide, and when isoprene, using the isoprene monomer, you are developing the polymer. This is cis polyisoprene, so it is the natural rubber. And when you are preparing this trans polyisoprene, this is called the gutta percha. Okay, so you just go through this text, what is written here. That is basically how to prepare this rubber, and there's some knowledge about the rubber material. You just go through it. In the next slide, we are going to discuss how to prepare the rubber. Okay. So here in these slides, I have separately shown you the isoprene monomer and the cis polyisoprene natural rubber. I am asking you to draw this structure in your notebook, because in your exam, if you get the question, write the structure of the natural rubber and the monomer, then it will be difficult for you to draw this structure until you practice it in your home. So please do it. Now we need to know the processing of rubber
from the agricultural crop, that is latex, and then we learn how to prepare the finished goods from the natural rubber. So to prepare the finished goods or some products from the natural rubber, we'll have to add some compounding agent to get the desired properties. So this compounding, mixing, shaping, vulcanizing, these are the important steps for the preparation of or the fabrication of products from the natural rubbers. So in the last slides, we have discussed how to produce rubber from the natural source, latex. So now I would like to recommend you to see this video where you will find the preparation of natural rubber from the latex, and this will help you to clarify the process for the synthesis of natural rubber from the latex. So you please go through this video. Now we would like to concentrate or to discuss a very important topic, that is the vulcanization of rubber. So in the exam you may get the question like write short note on the vulcanization of rubber, or you may get the question write the advantages of vulcanization of rubber, or what is the vulcanization, or what is the importance of the vulcanization of rubber. So this is very important thing to discuss. So vulcanization of rubber, this process was first discovered. It is discovered accidentally by Goodyear when he dropped rubber and sulfur on a hot stove. So he worked on the rubber and he added some sulfur into it. And he found that the strength of the rubber that has enhanced. So to improve the properties of rubber, it is compounded with some chemicals like sulfur, hydrogen sulfide, benzoyl chloride, and it is known as vulcanization of rubber. So if you have this natural rubber which is produced from the latex, and if you add these chemicals like sulfur, hydrogen sulfide, benzoyl chloride, you will get some improved properties, particularly the mechanical properties, and this process is called the vulcanization of rubber. So vulcanization results in cross-linking of the hydrocarbon chains by disulfide bonds. When the polymer is stretched, the chains no longer can slide past each other and tearing does not occur. So this thing I will show you in the next slide. So vulcanization results the cross-linking of the hydrocarbon chains by disulfide bonds. So let's see this.
So in the next two slides, I will show you the vulcanization process where the sulfur is cross-linked into the cis isoprene unit, that is the natural rubber. Okay, so you can see here there are two cis isoprene unit. Okay. So when we add the sulfur into it, it forms a cross-linking to that C double bond C, and here you can see the cross linking of sulfur into the C double bond C bond, and due to this cross linking, so the movement or the flexibility of that cis to isoprene units, that is restricted. So the process consists of heating the raw rubber with sulfur at 100 to 140 degrees centigrade. So you'll have to apply 100 to 140 degrees centigrade for this vulcanization process. The added sulfur combines chemically at the double bonds of different rubber strings. Thus, this process serves to stiffen the material by a sort of anchoring and the consequently preventing the intermolecular movement of rubber strings. So intermolecular movement is restricted here. The extent of stiffness of vulcanized rubber depend on the amount of sulfur added. Okay, so you draw the structures and then you add the sulfur into it. So if you get the question, the vulcanization of rubber, you will have to draw this figure in the answer sheet. Okay. So now it's the time to go through the advantages of vulcanization process. So a vulcanized rubber has good tensile strength and extensibility when a tensile force is applied. It has excellent resilience, means it can return to its original shape when the deforming load is removed. It possesses low water absorption tendency. It has higher resistance to oxidation. It has much higher resistance to wear and tear as compared to the raw rubber. So the mechanical properties are improved. So vulcanized rubber is a better electrical insulator, although it tends to absorb small amount of water. The vulcanized rubber is again resistant to organic solvents such as petrol, benzene and carbon tetrachloride, fats and oils. However, it swells in these liquids. Vulcanized rubber is very easy to manipulate the vulcanized rubber to produce the desired shape particles. It has useful temperature range of minus 40 to 100 degrees centigrade. So you can use this vulcanized rubber for wide range of application, where you can give the temperature starting from this minus 40 to 100 degrees centigrade. It has low elasticity and is depending on the extent of the vulcanization, and like this vulcanite that is having 32% sulfur has practically no elasticity. So you'll have to remember some points on the advantages of the vulcanization. Now the compounding of rubber. Compounding, sometimes we add some external agent to the natural rubber to get our desired properties, and these are as a whole called compounding agent. Compounding is mixing of the raw rubber with other substances so as to impart the specific properties to the product which are suitable for a particular job. Besides rubber, the following materials may be incorporated. So sometimes we add some softeners and plasticizers. So these are added to give the rubber greater tenacity and adhesion. So if you add these softeners and plasticizer, it will improve the tenacity as well as the adhesion of the natural rubber. They impart greater freedom of movement between the polymeric macromolecules of resins, thereby increasing the flexibility. So important materials are vegetable oils, wax, stearic acid, etc. These are the softeners. So already I have discussed this vulcanizing agent. I'm not going to discuss it again. So this is the vulcanizing agents like sulfur, hydrogen sulfide, benzoyl chloride. We add this as vulcanizing agents.
Some other compounding agents are accelerators. So these accelerators helps in shortening the time required for the vulcanization process. So the most used accelerators or catalysts are hydrogen peroxide, benzoyl peroxide, zinc oxide, metal like silver, copper, lead, etc. So these are called the accelerators, and it helps to make the vulcanization process faster. And then we have some other complex agents like antioxidants. Natural rubber has a tendency to attack by the oxidizing agents. So for this reason, antioxidation material such as complex amines like phenyl, naphthylamine and phosphates are added. We also use some reinforcing filler into the natural rubber to improve the mechanical properties. So these are added to give strength and rigidity to the rubber products. Common reinforcing fillers are carbon black, zinc oxide, calcium carbonate and magnesium carbonate, quartz, mica, asbestos. So these are used as reinforcing filler into the natural rubber. Sometimes we need to make the natural rubber in different color or different applications. So to add color into the natural rubber, we add different kind of compounding agents.
here we can say these are the coloring agents. So if you want to produce this white colored natural rubber, so we add this titanium dioxide. To get the green color, we add this chromium oxide. To get the red, we use the ferric oxide. Antimony sulfide is used to get the crimson red color, and then lead chromate is used for the making rubber in yellow color. So these are some of the compounding agents. So if I ask you the questions, describe the application of compounding agents in the natural rubber. So you'll have to tell or you'll have to write that compounding agents are the some external agents which we generally add into that materials, means natural rubber, to get the better properties. Desired properties, and then we'll have to explain all these things like compounding agents, accelerators, antioxidants, reinforcing fillers, coloring material, then vulcanizing agent. So all these things you need to describe. So, in the last slide, we have discussed mainly the natural rubber, how to get the natural rubber from the latex, how to improve the performance or properties of the rubber. We learned the vulcanization of rubber, we learned the different compounding of the rubber, and that was natural rubber. So now we will discuss some synthetic rubber. The synthetic rubber, you often call it elastomer. So as written here, so an elastomer is any vulcanizable man-made rubber like polymer which can be stretched to it at least twice its length, but it returns to its original shape and dimension as soon as stretching force is released. So this is man-made, means the synthetic rubber, okay, and it is called the elastomer. So if you stretch it, it will be stretched up at least twice its length, and when you will release the force, then it will return to the original shape. So the term of synthetic rubber is misnomer because it is not chemically identical with the natural rubber. The main types of artificial rubber produced on large scale are styrene rubber, nitrile rubber, neoprene. These are the some synthetic rubber and elastomers. So if I ask you the question, give some examples of synthetic rubber, you'll have to give answer like styrene rubber, nitrile rubber, neoprene. So since in the last slides we have learned many things about the natural rubber, so now it's the time to learn something about the synthetic rubber. So the synthetic rubber, styrene, we will learn the styrene rubber, nitrile rubber, and some neoprene. So first, the styrene rubber. Styrene rubber, it is again called the Buna S rubber or SBR. Buna S. So Buna is for BU for the butadiene. And then S means the styrene. So this is produced by copolymerization of butadiene and styrene. If you have butadiene 75% by weight and styrene about 25% by weight, and if you prepare the copolymer using this butadiene and then styrene, and here you can see the equations, chemical formula of butadiene and then styrene, and if you, and now you try to prepare this polymer and you will get this polybutadiene co-styrene. So you try to practice it in your notebook, and this is simple. You have one end butadiene, another is then styrene. So this is the styrene rubber, then this is called Buna S rubber. So So in the last slides, we have discussed how to produce rubber from the natural source latex. So now I would like to recommend you to see this video where you will find the preparation of natural rubber from the latex. And this will help you to clarify the process for the synthesis of natural rubber from the latex. So you please go through this video. Now we would like to concentrate or to discuss a very important topic, that is the vulcanization of rubber. So in the exam you may get the question like write short note on the vulcanization of rubber, or you may get the question write the advantages of vulcanization of rubber, or what is the vulcanization or what is the importance of the vulcanization of rubber. So this is very important thing to discuss. So vulcanization of rubber, this process was first discovered. It is discovered accidentally by Goodyear when he dropped rubber and sulfur on a hot stove. So he worked on the rubber and he added some sulfur into it. And he found that the strength of the rubber that has enhanced. And then use of this bunais. See, it is used for the manufacturing of motor tires, floor tire, tiles, shoes holes, gaskets, wire and cable insulations, carpet packing, adhesives, tank lining. So you remember, you have to remember the application of this bunais rubber. Now bunais, we have learned, now we will learn the buna-n. Again, buna means, it means butadiene, and n is acetonitrile. So it is a polymer, means it is a copolymer of butadiene and acrylonitrile. So here is the chemical structure of butadiene and the acrylonitrile, and it will form the polymer unit here, and you try to practice it in your notebook. Simply one side reagents are butadiene and acrylonitrile, and you draw the structure of this polymer bunain. So now it's the time to learn the is the bunain. So the nitrile rubber has very good oil and fuel resistance. It can perform over a wide temperature range. Can be blended up to 50% with polyvinyl chloride to produce compounds that exhibit good weathering characteristics in addition to good dynamic properties. And it can be copolymerized with the methacrylic and acrylic acid to produce carboxylated nitrile, which is noted for its excellent dynamic properties and application resistance. Now we'll learn the common application. So the application in the gaskets and seals, hoses, belting, rollers, cable jackets, textile, industrial footwear, insulation, and then molded extruded components for various industries and automotive, and fabric proofing. Okay, so the synthetic rubber, will learn this bunain synthesis, properties of bunain, properties of bunain, use of bunais and use of bunain we have learned. Now another synthetic polymer is that neoprene. Okay, so neoprene is made by the polymerization of chloroprene, a chlorinated butadiene. So you all of you know the butadiene, and here you can see the chloroprene means the chlorinated butadiene. So we'll learn the properties, so and then use of this neoprene. So properties, chloroprene is closely related chemically to natural rubber. The substitution of one hydrogen atom by chlorine atom produces superior resistance to vegetable and mineral oils, aging and high temperature, but at the same time accounts for greater solubility of neoprene in polar solvent. Okay, so it has better solubility in polar solvent, this chloroprene. neoprene. Uses, because of its high mechanical and chemical endurance, lot of common things are made up of the neoprene, such as gaskets, corrosion resistant coating, electrical insulation, sponges, hoses, conveyor belts, etc. See these synthetic rubbers, all these like bunais, bunayen and the neoprene, all these having are better mechanical properties, so that you can get the your desired desired mechanical strength, and it can be used for the different kind of industrial applications. So my recommendation or my suggestion is you go through that all the synthesis of these synthetic rubbers and their properties, and then uses.
So apart from this bunais, bunayen and the neoprene rubber, there is another important synthetic rubber that is called butyl rubber. And butyl rubber is made by the polymerization of isobutene with small amount of isoprene. So here you can see the chemical formula of the isoprene as well as the isobutene. So the reaction of isobutene and the isoprene, it will produce the butyl rubber. So properties, it has excellent resistance to heat, aging, chemicals, polar solvents, and it has high resistance to ozone and good electrical insulating properties. It is thus used for making cycle and automobile rubber tubes, automobile parts, tanks, linings. So in the last few slides, we have discussed the rubber. First, we have discussed this natural rubber. Then, we discussed about the synthetic rubber. Now, we will start discussing about the plastics. So, we will discuss about what is plastic, some of the properties of plastics, some of the general uses of the plastic materials. And then we'll discuss and we'll put more focus on the synthesis of some thermoplastic material, and then we'll discuss about the synthesis of some thermosetting polymers. So the plastic, all of you aware about the plastic materials, and if you just go through these slides, I think you will be able to understand the meaning of these texts. And so I would like to recommend you just go through the slides what is written. So again, still I am just going through these texts. So these are in general organic materials of high molecular weight, which can be molded into any desired form when subjected to heat and pressure in the presence of catalyst. So these are the organic materials of high molecular weight. If you heat treat it, it can be molded into any desired form, and if you release the heat and then if you cool it, it will form a shape, and that is, these materials are called plastic. The term plastics must be differentiated from the resins, because resins are the building block of the plastics. So resins are basic binding materials which form a major part of the plastics, and which actually has undergone polymerization and condensation reactions during their preparation. So the unique properties of plastics are lightness in weight. So all of you know that it is these plastic materials, one great advantage of these plastics is the light weight. Then good thermal and electrical insulation. It is both the thermally and as well as the electrically insulated. It has some good corrosion resistance power. So that's why we can easily we can work it with this material. So like this casting, molding, drilling, these plastic materials are easier to handle. Adhesiveness, then low fabrication cost into desired shape products.
its easy molding, already discussed, insect resistance, then chemical inertness to the action of light, oil and acids, transparency. Some of the plastics are highly transparent and that can be used for the optical lenses. Low maintenance cost, ability to take variety of colors, good mechanical strength and toughness, and high refractive index. So these are the basic properties, and all of you are aware about these properties, but it is sometimes become difficult when you write these in the answer sheet. So I will recommend, or I will suggest you to go through these properties once again. So the disadvantages of plastics over metals. So metals, we use plastics as an alternative of that metals, because sometimes it has low cost and it has light weight also. The disadvantage, sometimes some of the plastics are mostly that high cost. Combustibility, softness, deformation under load, embrittlement at low temperature, low heat resistance. These are the some of the disadvantages, like the softness, deformation under load, embrittlement at low temperature and low heat resistance. So uses of plastics. If I ask you the questions, you just give me some of the example where plastic materials are used, and you can give a variety of examples, since you are always seeing these many kind of plastic materials surrounding you. So like this, for making electrical goods in aeronautical engineering, for making furniture, for making special type of paints, for making floor and wall lining, and then for making the bearing for propeller shafts used in paper industry and rolling mill. And then for heat and sound insulation in cold storage, for preparing decorative laminations and then molding, and for making films and waterproofing. So for making household articles like comb, toys, trays. These are the some of the very important and useful applications of plastics. Now, as I told you, now we will first learn how to synthesize some of the thermoplastic materials, commercially important thermoplastics and commercially important thermoset materials. These are having high commercial impact. That's why we'll need to know about these polymers. So like polyethylene, all of you know. Polyethylene means we call is polythene, and polythene we can classify this polythene or polyethylene into two major types. One is that HDPE, means high density polyethylene, and another is the low density polyethylene, LDPE, and high density polyethylene is HDPE. So by using free radical initiator, low density polyethylene, and by using ionic catalyst, high density polyethylene is obtained. Now, HDPE consists of long chain of CH2 groups joined together in a linear fashion. It is produced by polymerization of ethylene at extremely high pressure using Ziegler-Natta catalyst, dispersed in N-heptane at 60 to 70 degrees centigrade under 6 to 7 atmosphere pressure. So it is prepared under high pressure at 60 to 70 degrees centigrade, and we use the Ziegler-Natta catalyst, and it is strong and hard because the linear chains pack well, resulting in stronger van der Waals interaction. So one thing you need to focus here, that HDPE means HDPE materials are prepared by using the linear chain polymer, not the cross-linked or branched polymer. So the linear chain polymers are used here to make this HDPE. When this linear chains are used, the packing will be more compact and the density will be high, and
To prepare these materials, we need to apply some heat as well as high pressure, and we also use some catalyst which is called the Ziegler-Natta catalyst. HDPE is used in following applications, like it is used in milk containers and water jugs. Because of better oxidation and UV resistance, HDPE is used in manufacturing of crates, wood tubes, industrial container, overhead tanks, etc. And then for high voltage cables application and for heat resistance films. So these are the use of the HDPE. Now LDPE means that low density polyethylene. As compared to that high density polyethylene, we used here the branched polymer chains. So the branching prohibits the chains from packing well. So here the packing is comparatively less, and when the packing is less, you can expect less density. So that's why it is called the low density polyethylene. So LDPE has weaker intermolecular interaction, making it a much softer material. LDPE is produced by free radical polymerization of ethylene under high pressure at 250 degrees centigrade in presence of traces of oxygen as initiator. The use of LDPE is used in films for general packaging and carrier bags. So what we used, that is basically the LDPE squeeze bottles, particularly for detergents, molded toys, ink tubes for paints. These are some used of low density polyethylene. So after polyethylene, the another thermoplastic is that polyvinyl chloride, PVC. We often use this PVC pipe. So PVC is common name to us. PVC is obtained by heating a water emulsion of vinyl chloride in presence of small amount of hydrogen peroxide or benzoyl peroxide catalyst in an autoclave under pressure. So vinyl chloride to polyvinyl chloride. The chemical formula of vinyl chloride is written here. So when n number of vinyl chloride is added together, we are getting a polymer that is called the polyvinyl chloride. So polyvinyl chloride is generally prepared by treating acetylene at 1 to 1.5 atmosphere pressure with hydrogen chloride at 60 to 80 degrees centigrade in presence of metal chloride as catalyst. So the transformation of this acetylene to vinyl chloride is written here. PVC, the properties: PVC is a colorless, odorless, non-inflammable and chemically inert powder, resistance to light, atmospheric oxygen, inorganic acids and alkalis, but soluble in hot chlorinated hydrocarbons such as ethyl chloride. It has greater stiffness and rigidity compared to polyethylene, but it is brittle. PVC is most widely used synthetic plastic. Okay. So the uses: rigid PVC or unplasticized PVC have superior chemical resistance. It is used for making sheets, which are employed for tank lining, light fitting, safety helmet, tires, cycle motorcycle mud guards. Then plasticized PVC is obtained by adding plasticizers like dibutyl phthalate, dioxyl phthalate. These are the some plasticizers. Is used for making continuous sheets. It is also employed for packing raincoats, table cloths and curtains, electrical insulation, injection molding of articles like toys, tool handles, toilet goods, etc. So PVC is a very important commercially very viable and having high impact. So it is used for different applications. So PVC, we need to know
the composition of PVC and how to get it. Okay.
Now we'll learn PTFE. PTFE means polytetrafluoroethylene. It is often called Teflon. Tetrafluoroethylene means you can see the chemical structure. Well, ethylene means it is nothing but the substituted ethylene, where the hydrogen atoms are replaced by the chlorine atoms. So it is obtained by polymerization of water emulsion of tetrafluoroethylene under pressure in presence of benzoyl peroxide as catalyst. So now the properties. So if you see the figures in the slide, so we'll be knowing that these are the Teflon sheets, and then Teflon which we used generally for different laboratories. So in the chemistry laboratory, this is an important accessories, and we often use it for sealing the reactors which are operative at high temperature. So the PTFE or Teflon is high temperature stable polymer. So now I'm going through the properties. Due to the presence of highly electronegative fluorine atoms, the polytetrafluoro molecules results in very strong attractive forces between the different chains. These attractive forces gives the molecule extreme toughness, high chemical resistance toward all chemicals except hot alkali and hot fluorine, high density, good electrical and mechanical properties. Around 350 degrees centigrade, it is stable. It sinters to form various viscous opaque mass, which can be molded into certain forms of applying high pressure. So see how this PTFE or Teflon is very beautiful and it is very attractive. See, the chemically it is very stable, and it is stable up to very high temperature. So whenever you are finding a material which is also chemically inert at high temperature, and then you will always remember that Teflon, PTFE. So this is very useful polymer. So uses as insulating material for transformer cables, wires, etc. It is used for making gaskets, packing pump parts, tank linings, etc. for coating and impregnating glass fibers. Okay. Polyester, it is again a thermoplast. It is again a thermoplast material. It is not thermoset. This is thermoplast. And polyesters are formed by the condensation of dicarboxylic acid with dihydroxy alcohols. And you know the condensation of acid and alcohols will give you the esters. So condensation of dicarboxylic acid with the dihydroxy alcohols will give you the polyester. For example, the reaction of tetraethylic acid and ethylene glycol. Here the chemical formulas are written, tetraethylic acid and then ethylene glycol. So it forms the polyethylene tetraethylate by the condensation reaction. It is a polymer commonly used in plastic soda bottles. So the mostly PET bottles, that is written the PET bottles in many plastic bottles. These are nothing but the polyethylene tetraethylate bottles. And it is also sold as Dacron, lightweight and durable material used in the textile manufacturing. Unsaturated polyester resins are prepared by heating an unsaturated dibasic acid and glycols for 10 to 12 hours at about 160 to 200 degrees centigrade under stirring condition and under nitrogen atmosphere. So this is basically the reaction, and you have to write these equations, this tetraethylic acid and then ethylene glycol, and due to the condensation reaction of these both these reagents, you will be getting the polyethylene tetraethylene, PET. Okay, so
So now we have discussed the different kind of thermoplastics. Now we will discuss the different kind of thermosetting polymers. We have completed the discussion on that thermoplastic materials. It's the time to go to discuss the thermosetting polymers. Okay, so from the next slide we'll discuss the thermosetting polymers. So now we are going to discuss about some commercially very important thermosetting polymers. We have already discussed about the thermoplast and the thermosetting polymers. We know the difference between the thermoplastics and the thermosetting polymers. The thermosetting polymers are those polymers when you cool it, it will set, and then if you heat it, it will not revert it back to its softened state. So means this conversion from this hard to soft material is not visible here for these thermosetting polymers. We'll discuss some of the thermosetting polymers here. Some of the important thermoset polymers are phenol formaldehyde polymer, urea formaldehyde polymer, epoxy resin. Those things we will discuss here. So phenol formaldehyde resin, the common name of this phenol formaldehyde resin is Bakelite. Bakelite is industrially very important thermoset polymer. So first we will learn how to prepare this Bakelite. So as written here, these are formed by condensation polymerization and are thermosetting, and these are thermosetting polymers. These are prepared by condensing phenol with formaldehyde in presence of acidic or alkali catalyst. So you can see in the figure, the reagents are phenol and the formaldehyde. So in presence of acid or base catalyst, H plus is here shown. So it will first form the ortho and para-hydroxy methyl phenol. So you can see phenol in one product, that is that hydroxymethyl is in ortho position, and in another product the hydroxymethyl is in para position. So the formation of ortho and para hydroxymethyl phenol from the phenol and the formaldehyde. So this is the first step for the formation of this resin. Now this ortho hydroxymethyl phenol, it can form a linear polymer when reacted with phenol, and that linear polymer chain is called novolact. So first step is the formation of ortho and para hydroxymethyl phenol. Then ortho hydroxymethyl phenol will add with the phenol, and it will form a linear polymer. That polymer is called novolac. In the next slide, I will show you the structure of novolac. And then after the formation of novolac, that we use some hexamethylene tetraamine. It's a base. Hexamethylene tetraamine, it converts the soluble and fusible novolac into the hard, infusible and insoluble solid of cross-linked structure. So again I am saying, in the first step, phenol plus formaldehyde, it will give you the ortho and para hydroxy methyl phenol. Then ortho hydroxy methyl phenol will react with the phenol, it will form the linear chain, and this linear chain is called novolac. Then if you add this hexamethylene tetraamine, that hexamethylene tetraamine will convert that novolac into a hard, infusible and insoluble solid cross-linked structure, and that is called the Bakelite. So now we are moving to the next slide, where you will find this type of reaction. So in the first step, here you can see the ortho hydroxy methyl phenol and then para hydroxy methyl phenol. So in the last slide, you have seen the formation of ortho hydroxy methyl phenol and the para hydroxy methyl phenol. due to the reaction of phenol and then formaldehyde. Now this orthohydroxymethyl phenol, it will react with the phenol and it will form a linear chain, and that linear chain is called novolath. So the chemical formula of novolath is shown here. So you try to draw this figure in your notebook. It will help you to answer the question in the exam, because it requires some practice. Without practice, it will be very difficult to draw these structures. Okay. Now, after the formation of this novolac, that will form a cross-linked polymer, and this cross-linked polymer is shown here, and this is nothing but the bakelite. So the common name of this cross-linked polymer is called bakelite, and here you can see some of the images of the bakelite. I think most of you are aware about this bakelite, but maybe you don't know the chemical name of this bakelite. So this phenolic resin said to resist hard, infusible, water resistant, insoluble solid, but are attacked by alkali because of the presence of free hydroxyl group in their structure. You can see some of the free hydroxyl groups are present in the bakelite, so it may be prone to that alkali. They are used for making electric insulator parts like switches, plugs, switchboards, telephone parts. They also use in paints. They are used as hydrogen exchanger resins in water softening, for making bearing in propeller shafts for paper industry and rolling mills. Okay, so you may get the question like what is bakelite, and or you may get the question what is the phenol formaldehyde resin. So you'll have to write the preparation method of this bakelite from the phenol and then formaldehyde. Step by step, first step is the synthesis of orthohydroxymethyl phenol and parahydroxymethyl phenol. Then the condensation reaction of orthohydroxymethyl phenol with the phenol, and that will produce the novolac, and the novolac ultimately will produce the cross-linked polymer bakelite. So you will have to draw the figures, and then you will have to describe the uses of this bakelite for different industrial applications. So this is all about the bakelite. Another important thermosetting polymer is urea formaldehyde resin. The bakelite we have discussed, phenol formaldehyde. Now in this slide, we are going to discuss about the urea formaldehyde resin. So here you can see the chemical structure of urea as well as the structure of formaldehyde. So this urea and the formaldehyde, these can undergo condensation polymerization, and after this condensation polymerization, it forms the thermosetting polymer, and it is called the urea formaldehyde thermosetting polymer. So you'll have to draw the structures of this urea and then formaldehyde, and here you can see the condensation reactions and the loss of water. Due to the loss of water, you can see the urea formation of urea formaldehyde polymer. The three-dimensional cross-linked structure of the polymer makes it a thermosetting polymer and does not soften on heating. Okay. So urea formaldehyde resins give clear water white products of good tensile strength, good electrical insulation, good chemical resistance, great hardness. It is used for bonding grinding wheels, binder of glass fibers, raw wool. It is also used as cation exchanger, electrical insulation, decorative articles like plates, drinking glasses, dishes, etc. So you'll have to remember, if you get the question, that write short note on the urea formaldehyde resin. So you'll have to draw the structure of urea and formaldehyde, and then you will have to perform this condensation reaction. And after this condensation reaction, you will have to show that you are getting a network of urea and then formaldehyde, and that is basically a thermoset polymer. And when it is a thermoset polymer, it will be used for different applications, for different industrial applications. So what purpose these are used, you will have to describe. Okay, now one more example of this thermoset polymer is the epoxy resin. Epoxy resin, so the glue which we used, if I give you the example of that dendrite, that glue, and these glue are mostly this epoxy resin. So epoxy resins are the material of which epoxy glue is comprised. Epoxy resins consist of two components, a fluid free polymer composed of short polymer chains with reactive epoxides on each end, and a hardener, usually a diamine or a triamine, that ring opens the epoxides and cross-links the chain together. So in the epoxy resin, you have two components. One component is the epoxy resin, and that is having a short polymer chains, and another is a diamine or triamine that will help to open the epoxy rings. So the pre-polymer is formed by reacting to different functional monomers, bisphenol A and the epichlorohydrin. So in the next slide, we are going to discuss about the formation or the synthesis of epoxy resin. So here you can see the preparation of epoxy resins. You can see the epichlorohydrin and the bisphenol, the chemical structure of epichlorohydrin and the bisphenol. After this reaction, you can see the formation of epoxy resin, and this reaction occur in alkaline catalyst environment, and it is performed at moderate temperature like 60 degrees centigrade. So epichlorohydrin and the bisphenol will give you the epoxy resin. Now these properties of the epoxy resins. Epoxy resins have ability of getting cured without application of heat. So you take the example of any glue like dendrite or fabric stick, this kind of thing. So epoxy resins have ability of getting cured without application of heat. So when you use this type of glue, I think you don't use any kind of heat treatment. So basically it is cured at room temperature. They have good resistance to chemicals. They have less shrinkage during curing process. They may be used in solid or liquid form. They possess excellent electrical resistance. Epoxy resins stick well to a number of substances, including metal and glass. Their properties can be modified by adding compounds like unsaturated fatty acid or amines and some of the solvents. So these are the properties, and you will have to remember the properties of these epoxy resins. Okay, so this is all about the some of the important thermoset polymer. So three different of thermoset polymers you are now aware about. So first is that phenol formaldehyde resin, that is the bakelite. Second one is the urea formaldehyde thermoset polymer, and then third one is the epoxy resin. So you need to go through this preparation, properties, and then use. Okay, so use, you just go through these slides of epoxy resins are mainly used as adhesives. They are used for surface coatings. Molds are made with epoxy resins, which are used for the production of metallic components of aircrafts and automobiles. They are used as laminating and casting materials, and epoxy resins are used as coating compounds from electrical equipments. So these are the uses of this epoxy resins.
Now we will learn about some commercially very important polymeric fiber. So we will learn about the nylon 6/6 and the nylon 6. These are very useful polymeric fiber and used for different industrial purpose. We will learn how to prepare this nylon 6/6 and the nylon 6, and then we will discuss about their properties and what are the differences between the nylon 6/6 and the nylon 6. We will learn. So first, as you can see in the figure, the nylon 6/6 is prepared basically from this adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. Adipic acid, here you can see it's adipic acid, and then hexamethylene diamine, it's again NH2 groups are present, two NH2 groups are present. So adipic acid, it is in acidic in nature, and hexamethylene diamine, it's a basic in nature. So due to this acid base reaction, there is a formation of polyhexamethylene diamine epidamide, and this is called the nylon 6/6. So in the exam you can get the question, write the formation of nylon 6/6. So you'll have to describe these reactions, you'll have to write these reactions. So I'm suggesting you to draw these reactions in your notebook and you practice it. Okay. So this is basically nylon 6/6 preparation. Then nylon 6. Nylon 6 is prepared from the caprolactam. Caprolactam, it's a 7-membered ring, and here it is written nylon 6 is another polyamide which is made by heating an aqueous solution of caprolactam. 7-membered ring of the lactam is ring open to form 6 aminohexanoic acid, the monomer that reacts with more lactam to form the polyamide chain. So first you have this ring of caprolactam, and then caprolactam opens to some aminocapronoic acid, that is 6 aminohexanoic acid, and then it will form the poly 6 aminohexanoic acid. This is called nylon 6. So difference between the nylon 6 and the nylon 6/6 in the preparation methodology, if you find, then for the nylon 6/6 you have two reagents, that is adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine for the preparation of nylon 6/6, but here for the preparation of nylon 6 you have only one reagent starting material, that is caprolactam. We'll now see the difference between the nylon 6 and the nylon 6/6. So the nylon 6, it's a less crystalline. Nylon 6/6 is more crystalline. Nylon 6 is lower mold shrinkage, and nylon 6/6 have higher greater mold shrinkage. Nylon 6 lower melting point, nylon 6/6 having higher melting point. In nylon 6 lower heat deflection temperature, nylon 6/6 higher heat deflection temperature. Nylon 6 is having higher water absorption rate, nylon 6/6 has comparatively lower water absorption rate. Nylon 6, it's poor chemical resistance to acids, whereas nylon 6/6 is better chemical resistance to acid. Nylon 6 withstands high impact and stress and better stands up to hydrocarbons. Better stiffness, tensile modulus and flexural modulus will be obtained from the nylon 6/6. Lustrous surface finish, easy to color in the nylon 6, more difficult to color for this nylon 6/6. Okay, so these are all about the nylon 6 and the nylon 6/6
very important, the preparation of nylon 6,6 and the nylon 6. So you'll have to draw the chemical structure and the formation of this nylon 6,6 and nylon 6. So you just practice it, okay?
So in the last few slides, we have learned about many natural rubber, synthetic rubber, thermoplastic materials, thermosetting polymers. So these are having huge impact on the commercial market and they are used for different industrial purposes. Here in these slides, we will learn other two kind of plastic, engineering plastics. Here you can see there are polyamides and nylons and teflon. That is number 1 and number 4. We have already discussed in detail. Apart from these two important plastic material, we have other two like polycarbonate and polyurethane, which are used very extensively for the different engineering processes. So these are important engineering plastics. Polycarbonates possess high impact and tensile strength over a wide range of temperature, stiffness, transparency, etc. They are used in sockets, plugs, cooking utensils, covers, camera and bionuclear bodies, telephone booths. Polycarbonates are prepared by interaction of diphenyl carbonate with bisphenol A. So we are not going to the detail of these polycarbonates because we have discussed so many of these engineering plastics. And if you are interested, you can go through the synthesis of these polycarbonates and the polyurethane and from the reference books which I have given to you. So polyurethane means it possesses excellent flexibility, toughness, excellent resistance to solvents. They are used in different oceanographic research, mountain engineering, etc. It is prepared by treating diisocyanate and diol. That is 1,4-butanediol with 1,6-hexamethylene diisocyanate. So if you are interested on the polycarbonate material and the polyurethane material, you just get this information from the referred books which I have given in the first slides. Okay. So biopolymer, as the name suggests, these polymers which we get from the living beings. So you can see here polymers present in living matter, animals or plants are termed as biopolymers. Biopolymers can be classified in 4 categories. First one is the carbohydrate, second one is the protein, third one is the nucleic acid, and then natural rubber. Natural rubber, you can say it is a biopolymer since we are getting it from the barks of rubber trees, and the scientific name of the rubber trees is Hevea brasiliensis, you know. And we get the latex from the barks of the rubber trees, and from that latex this natural rubber is prepared. So we can call this natural rubber as biopolymer. So apart from this natural rubber, some carbohydrate, they are polyhydroxyaldehydes and ketone. Polyhydroxy, as carbohydrates are polyhydroxy, so these are polymer also. They are an important class of compounds as they provide us with necessary nutrients, for example starch, cellulose. So the starch, cellulose, you can consider as biopolymer. So these are carbohydrates. Proteins. Proteins are the essential building blocks of life as they make up a large part of the animal body. Proteins can be of two types, fibrous proteins and the globular proteins. Proteins again can be considered as the biopolymer since it is found in the animal body. Nucleic acid, again it plays an essential role in the biosynthesis of protein. So protein, you know that this is the amide linkage. Okay. So nucleic acids, two kinds of nucleic acids exist.
These are the oxyribonucleic acid and ribonucleic acid. These are, you can consider as biopolymer also. So there are four different biopolymers, we can say. Those can be achieved from the animal or plant, that is from the living matters. So carbohydrates, proteins, nucleic acids, and then natural rubber. Okay. It's a time to know about a different class but very important polymer, that is conducting polymer. So if you find in your surroundings, very few items you will find that is prepared from the conducting polymer, because generally we use this plastics for different kind of household or different kind of industrial application where this conductivity is not required. But in some cases, this conductivity of the polymer is important. So the polymers having the conductivity, that is the electrical conductivity, is called the conducting polymers. So now we will learn how we can achieve conductivity in a polymer. Or is there any polymer which is by itself a conducting polymer? So we'll learn about it. So I'm going through the text which is written over here. Ordinary polymers obtained by usual method of polymerization are nearly insulator. That I told you, the polymers which can conduct current are called conducting polymers. Conducting polymers can be classified into following categories. The first one, conductive element filled polymer. So suppose you have this polymer which is obviously insulator, but you want to make it conducting for some purpose. So if you add some conducting elements into the polymer, insulating polymer, you may get some kind of conductivity. So if you add this carbon black metallic fiber, you can get the conductivity within the polymer. Now conjugated pi electrons conducting polymer. So there are polymer which are originally actually the conducting, means by property they are conducting since they have a conjugated double bonds. And that conjugated double, due to the presence of these conjugated double bonds, they can transport the electronic charge. So this kind of conducting polymers, it is a polymer that consists of alternating single and double bonds called conjugated double bonds. In conjugation, the bonds between the carbon atoms are alternatively single and double. Every bond contains a localized sigma bond which forms a strong chemical bond. In addition, every double bond also contains a less strongly localized pi bond which is weaker. In an electric field, conjugated pi electrons of the polymers excited, thereby it can be transported through the solid polymeric material. So if you have this conjugated double bond and single bond, means first single bond then double bond, in this pathway the electronic charge can be transported through the polymeric material. So the common example is the polyanion, when it is called poly. In the next slide I will show you the structure of the polyanion. And if you are interested, if you are doing some project work or in future, if you face any problem where you require this conducting polymer, you can remember this at some point you have studied this conducting polymer, and these conducting polymers are mainly this polyanilin. Okay. So number 3 is that doped conducting polymer. It is obtained by exposing a polymer to a charged transfer agent in either gas phase or in solution. In general, doping increases the surface conductivity of the polymer. So sometimes if you dope some material in the polymer, you can get the conductivity in the polymer. And blended conducting polymer, blended conducting polymers means you have, suppose here you can see the polyaniline chain, and polyaniline chain you can see that the conjugated bond present, means single bond, double bond, then single bond, double bond, this arrangement, and this will help to conduct the electronic charge. And now if you mix this conducting polymer with a insulating polymer, you can get some kind of conductivity in the insulating polymer. So you can say this conductivity results due to the blending. So if you blend an insulating polymer with a conducting polymer, then the blend can result the electronic conductivity, and these are the conducting polymers. So factors that affect the conductivity: with the increase in the length of conjugation in a given polymer, so that is again very important, length of conjugation. With the increase in the doping level of the polymer, conductivity is found to increase up to a certain limit. After that, it remains constant. And then temperature. Also, the temperature has a big role on the conductivity of that conducting polymer. So these are the factors which influence the conductivity of conducting polymer. These conducting polymers are used in the transistors, LEDs, solar cells, and display devices. Okay, so these are all about the conducting polymer. Now it's a very important topic, the problem with polymer synthesis. See, we are preparing different kind of polymers. So if you take the example of some synthetic polymer, take the example of nylon 66. You see the nylon 66, if you can recall that for the synthesis of nylon 66, we have used adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. Nylon 66 is a very important, commercially important polymer. Or you can see the fiber, polymeric fiber, and this is prepared from the adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. Now you know this adipic acid and the hexamethylene diamine, both are prepared from the crude oil. Crude oil means this is a non-renewable raw material. So you can see in the first step or the first diagram, you can see the synthesis of the adipic acid from the benzene. So benzene is a petroleum product, and then benzene, use of benzene, it's not very good for the environment because it is carcinogenic in nature. And then adipic acid, what is obtained from the benzene, it reacts with the hexamethylene diamine to form the nylon 66. So I am going through this slide. Until recently, the feedstock of all polymer synthesis has been petroleum. The monomers of virtually all polymer synthesis are made from crude oil. A renewable raw material, for example, nylon 66, is prepared industrially from adipic acid and 1,6-diaminohexane or hexamethylene diamine, both of which originate from benzene, a product of petroleum refining. The adipic acid synthesis of nylon 66 has other problems. The use of benzene, a carcinogen and liver toxin, is undesirable, particularly in the large quantities demanded by the large-scale industrial reaction. The required oxidation with HNO3 in step 3 produces N2O as a byproduct. N2O, you can say this NOx gas. N2O depletes ozone in the stratosphere. It also absorbs thermal energy from the Earth's surface like CO2 and may thus contribute to the global warming. So if you want to prepare the polymeric materials, mostly we use the petroleum resources, and in different steps we use some toxic chemicals, or we are getting some toxic hazards throughout the reaction. So these are not desirable if you consider the safety of the environment. So these are some problems associated with the polymer synthesis. So if you get the question in the exam, describe the problems associated with the polymer synthesis. So you write that the polymers are mostly obtained from the petroleum resources, and you give the example of the nylon 66, and nylon 66 is prepared from that adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. Then you write the steps from the for the preparation of adipic acid from the benzene, and you show that benzene is a product of the crude oil and it is carcinogenic in nature. And in one step you are using this H2O3 and you are getting the N2O byproduct, and N2O can deplete the ozone layer in the stratosphere, and that's why they are creating an impact, bad impact you can say, on the environment. So the thus you can write the problems associated with the polymer synthesis. So if there is a problem associated with the polymer synthesis from the petroleum resources, so there should be some kind of methodologies or some kind of research activities which will give us the polymers through a greener way. So people are working on that, because researchers are always finding an alternative route for all the processes which are having some environmental impact. So this is basically the target of the environmental engineers. So the researchers are working on it. Similarly, researchers are also trying to prepare the commercially impactful polymers through the greener approach. And in the next slide, I will show you the green synthesis or green approaches for the synthesis of polymer, and taking the example of this nylon 66. So the green polymer synthesis, I'm now going through the text what is written here. The negative environment impact of polymer synthesis has promoted the development of green polymer synthesis. The use of more environmentally benign method to synthesize the polymers. So to date, green polymer synthesis has been approached in a variety of ways, using starting materials that are derived from renewable sources rather than petroleum. So as I told you, don't use the petroleum resources, but try to use some of the renewable sources, some of the green sources, which can give you the desired product by producing less toxic materials or the materials having without toxicity. So using safer, less toxic reagents that from fewer byproducts, carrying out reactions in the absence of solvent or in aqueous solution instead of an organic solvent. You know, for the green chemistry, that is very important. So if it is possible, you avoid the use of organic solvents, because the organic solvents, it can create more toxicity in the nature. It can have a bad impact on your health. So better not to use this organic solvent. And again, organic solvents are also costly. So either you perform the chemical reactions in aqueous solvents, or you go through the net reactions, means without having any kind of solvent. But without having any kind of solvent, sometimes it is very difficult to go through, because for the homogeneity of the reaction mixture, it is important to have the solvent. But that's why, if possible, use aqueous solvent, avoiding the organic solvents. So these are the strategies for the synthesis of polymers through the green approaches. So here you can see some of the approaches. Like chemists at Michigan State University have devised a two-step synthesis of adipic acid from glucose. So earlier we have seen that the adipic acid is prepared from the benzene. So benzene is a carcinogenic and is a petroleum product. But now, instead of benzene, if we can use the glucose, you see the adipic acid in the following diagram, flow diagram, you can see the synthesis synthesis of adipic acid from glucose. In this scheme, you can see that glucose is converted to that adipic acid in presence of E. coli bacteria, and it is, you can say, the cleaner approach than using the benzene as a starting material. So by this way, if we can reduce the use of toxic material or toxic byproducts for the synthesis of polymers, it will really help us to combat against the pollution and to get the better or safer environment. Okay. So now we are on the last slide of the polymer chapter. In fact, this thing, the idea about the processing of products from polymers, these are not in your syllabus, but since you will be the future engineer, so you need to know the engineering processes, how to prepare the polymeric materials. So suppose you want to prepare a bottle, how will you prepare that bottle? Suppose you want to prepare a complex design of polymer, how will you make that design? How will you process that polymer? So these things are important, very important to know. So some of the techniques that are very useful for the polymer processing, that injection molding, extrusion, blow molding, these are the some important techniques which you should know, and it will actually give you some benefit. So I will suggest you just go through these YouTube links, where you will find the process of injection molding, extrusion, blow molding, this kind of process. You will be able to know how these polymer bags are prepared, how these plastic bags, plastic bottles, plastic panes, or any kind of structure is prepared. So these things you will be learning through the this YouTube links. So please go through it. So this is all about the polymer chapter. Thank you all for the listening.